I messed up tonight.
Hello and welcome to Waly Gisnep's Animated Classics, the podcast dedicated to reviewing each and every one of the so-called Walt Disney animated classics, putting aside their influence and our own nostalgia to try and objectively analyse them and decide whether we think they're worthy of going on our own refined list of Waly Gisnep's animated classics. My name's Ben and joining me as always is my good friend Liam. Liam, which film are we looking at this time?
I hope you're ready for a flood of inappropriate crushes on anthropomorphic animals, because we are taking a look at 2016's Zootopia.
I'm just going to jump in. I'm not ready for that, but we can still do the podcast.
As someone who has said that one of their favourite Disney films is Robin Hood, you are the reason for this film's existence.
I resent that.
We should also state this film was released under the title Zootropolis in many regions, specifically the UK and I think possibly other Commonwealth regions. I couldn't find a full list. And I think it's because there is a wildlife sanctuary slash zoo in the UK called Zootopia. And so there was just a whole legal hoo-ha. And what I love about this is that they had to go back and redo every mention of the name Zootopia in the film. If you're not familiar with the process of making an animated film, recording the audio is one of the earliest things you do once you enter actual production. And this lawsuit came very late in the production, so you had to pull in all the cast again, including Shakira, which it's so funny to me that someone at Disney had to make the call to Shakira and say, I know you've only got one line in this film and you recorded it 12 months ago, but can you come in and record it again for us, please?
Shakira, how much do you know about British zoos?
Weirdly enough, when she first came in to record, she was like, isn't this name already taken?
So as always, we are going to talk a little bit about the background of this film, go through the plot, decide who we think is the sexiest character in this film, before finally deciding whether we think Zootopia is a true animated classic. And as you mentioned with the comparison to Robin Hood, this is one of those few Disney films where it's about animals, but they are anthropomorphic animals. You know, this isn't Bolt, the Aristocats, 101 Dalmatians or whatever. These are animals that live in a big modern city and are, to all intents and purposes, human, but also they're still animals with weird proportions.
Yeah, I think overall the world they've built is a lot of fun, and they put a lot of thought into, okay, well, if it was a world with all of these different animals in, what would it look like? How would it have evolved? And how would everyone interact? I do think there are a couple of moments where it's very much, this is just our world, but with animals. So for example, at one point, one of our protagonists, Judy Hopps, is listening to the radio and REM is on it. And I'm thinking, do REM exist in this world, or is there a turtle version of REM?
Michael Stipe? Michael Pike? That's the best I've got.
Ah, that's much better. Though, you say Pike. Quick plot hole, elephant in the room situation. There is a discussion about what some of the carnivorous animals actually eat. And I believe the directors have gone on record as saying it's very much plant protein, insect protein, and fish. But the fish one, whilst it was in an earlier draft, they didn't want to put it into the film because it kind of breaks the world a little bit and raises that question. So they thought, let's just not ask the question and hope the audience also don't ask it. But the audience did. Because, yeah, it is exclusively a world of mammals, which does unfortunately mean we have no Alan a Dale like we do in Robin Hood. It's just the mammals.
Which is, again, consistent with our brother bear world, where when you're an animal, you can talk to other animals except fish, which are still stupid and you can just eat and that's fine and they don't feel pain.
Tell that to fish out of water. Actually, now I say that, I got no indication in that film that he was intelligent or could feel pain. So shall we dive into the plot of Zootopia, Zootropolis, Zootopolis?
Let's do. I mean, my first note is Zootopia is clearly the better name because it actually works as a pun, whereas Zootropolis doesn't. So I'm going to call it Zootopia for this because I think that's what it's normally known as.
Yeah, the playoff Utopia versus Metropolis, one is much more in line with the theming, which we'll discuss.
Oh, I've got a lot to say on the theming, my friend. So we open with a little bit of a play being put on by some mammal kids, basically giving us a little bit of exposition as to the rules of this universe, saying mammals used to be what they are in our world, which are, you know,
fluffy,
feral, savage, fluffy, but also wild, and they're either predators or prey, and saying that they then evolved and they don't do that anymore, and now animals can be whatever they want. And it's during this time we're introduced to our main character, Judy Hopps, a bunny who wants to be a police officer, which is unheard of in the world of Zootopia.
I'm really uncomfortable with the prospect of a world in which there has never been a bunny police officer.
There's bunny police officers in our world. Admittedly, they're normally mascots, but still.
So, immediately, I quite like this premise of you don't have to be pigeonholed based on essentially who you are. You can be anything you want to be. And one thing we get in this setup is we show Judy Hopps at various stages. We show her standing up to a bully. I think there's a scratch that I find very underwhelming every time I watch this. She gets into a fight with a fox. The fox scratches her. There's no blood. I know it's a kid's film, but I'm always like, give me a little bit of blood. And also, maybe give her a scar for the rest of the film.
Yeah, I feel this is a weird anti-setup in terms of the scar, because I was like, oh, is this going to be a visual reminder of something later on? But yeah, nope. That's never mentioned again. One thing I do like, and we get it a few times during this first act with Judy, is where it sets it up as if the next section of the film is going to be one thing, and then it's not. So the example here is she's bullied and told, you know, you'll never be anything like this. And you think, okay, so the next bit of Hopps' character development is that she has to overcome this and find her confidence. But no, she's already got her confidence and she already knows what she wants to do. And just because she's been beaten, that doesn't change who she is. And we get that multiple times throughout this, where every time she has something shit, you know, the police training camp shit on her, like her new apartment when she moves to the city is shit, her superior officer is horrible to her, and she just decides that her character arc isn't learning to deal with those things. She can already deal with those things because she's awesome.
Well, this is something I actually do like about this first act, is what we do is we follow Judy through her progression. We see her applying to be a police officer. She struggles at the training camp. Then she has the turnaround moment in the montage, and suddenly she is smashing the training, eventually graduating top of her class and getting sent to, I think it's like the first central district of Zootopia, making her not only the first bunny police officer, but the first bunny police officer in arguably the most important jurisdiction.
Animal Brooklyn, basically.
Yeah, basically. Animal Brook, that's a good name for the film.
Zooklyn? No, it doesn't work.
And yeah, we see her superior officer, voiced wonderfully by Idris Elba, who is very dismissive of her. And one thing I really like in this first act is it's set up kind of as a story about sexism, because what we really see when we get to Zootopia is the major prey animals we see are all female, and they're all basically being told to stay in their lane. And as a result, we've set up a film where it's like, it's basically G.I. Jane, where it's like, you don't have to be what everyone tells you you should be. And I do think that is done quite well in this first act.
I'd agree with that, and I wouldn't exactly say it's a fake out, because I think it's deliberately explored and then the film moves on to a different theme. I think that is well handled.
And I do think they are deliberately going for that angle of overcoming sexism in this first act, because alongside Judy, we've got the parallel of the assistant mayor, who is a female sheep, again, a prey animal, working for the mayor. J.K. Simmons as a lion is just, it's just Cave Johnson, but it's perfect casting. And again, she's the assistant mayor. He's treating her as a glorified secretary, basically. We've got these kind of sexist overtones to it. That phrase makes it sound like the film is sexist.
The characters are sexist, yes. Certainly. Or presented as such. Again, I think it does a good job of leading you down one path, which is this film is an underdog story. So we start with someone at the bottom of the rung and they have to work their way up to earn the respect of their colleagues, which I think is a subplot. But the way it's set up in this first act is that that's what the focus of the plot is going to be. I think throughout this film, we get a lot of basically animal analogies to reflect biases and discrimination in the real world. An early example of this, which links to the sexism, is Hops being called cute because she's a rabbit, and she says that it's not appropriate to call rabbits cute, which obviously has very clear parallels with, you know, sexism in the workplace and the way women are treated.
I do wish they had rewritten that line to be more focused on that, because the way it is written is it's basically a one-to-one parallel with basically the N-word.
Yeah.
And I think, well, okay, I'm just going to say it. Eventually this film does evolve into more of an allegory about prejudice in general, and the strongest theming really being racism as a form of discrimination. And I think they drop the hints of that a bit too early with some of the writing, and I think they should have focused more on the sexism and then naturally evolved it into the story about wider prejudice. Like, there's a part sort of around the midpoint where our second protagonist, who we're going to meet shortly, Nick, is basically touching Maya Bellwether's hair, and that is ripped straight out of what a lot of black people find is white people's obsession with natural afro hair and wanting to touch it. And I remember watching it this time and being like, yikes, I can't believe they actually did this and played it for a joke, because it's too close to a real world issue to be played for a joke for me.
I think what you're saying sums up my feelings about it very well, which is, I think putting it in was a good idea because it's something a lot of people can identify with, and Judy's very quick to say, like, that is so, so not cool. But also, it is played for a bit of a joke and a almost observational comedy of, like, you can recognise this, you know, people have been in this situation, and that can be a bit of a theme throughout this film. But let's not get too far ahead of ourselves. We haven't really talked about the city of Zootopia itself. How would you describe this to someone who's not seen this film, Liam, and what are your thoughts on it?
Zootopia, to me, is beautifully realised. We get this gorgeous introductory montage taking you through the various biomes that they have that are accounting for all the different species, as we see. The public transport has different entrances and exits that accommodate for the different sizes, and different species will arrive in the city in different ways. We get this nice shot of like hippos coming in, and then as soon as they arrive through this kind of water slide system, there's like a air dryer that just dries them off in their suits, and then they're ready for work.
I think visually the different biomes and environments are really well realised, and it gives the film a lot of visual variety. It's a really good way of setting up, right, this section of the film is in a rainforest, this section of the film is in Tundra World or whatever, which means they can really show off all the different animation they've perfected over the last however many years at Disney. I like the subplot of how each biome has to send two champions every year to enter the Hunger Games.
One thing I do find quite odd is that as Judy is arriving in Zootopia, our theme of the film, sung by Shakira in the form of the character Gazelle, plays. And I've got to say, I do quite like this song. I don't think this is the right place to use it because it's a song about not giving up. If anything, it should have gone over the montage of her at the police training academy. So much so that the actual music video for this song is her at the police training academy.
So despite being top of her class and being super enthusiastic, Judy is assigned to parking tickets on her first assignment. And although initially a little deflated and told that she should write 100 tickets a day, she decides she's going to write 200 tickets by noon and just absolutely blitzes it. And again, I'm just going to say it, Judy Hopps is one of my favourite Disney characters because I guess she's kind of got the Mulan thing going for her in terms of she's an underdog and, you know, she has to kind of use ingenuity and drive to get through problems. But I think it's just the unrelenting drive she's got and that she refuses to be beaten down by anything that really makes me like her.
My favourite part of this sequence is when she ends up giving herself a ticket. As just a really nice moment of just saying, this is someone who is completely driven and committed to the work they're doing. They do everything by the book, and they give it their all. I think this sequence is probably the first real insight we get to the character of Judy. Obviously, we've seen her standing up to her bully, Gideon, as a kid, and her at the training academy. But this, you know, she's basically had her dreams dashed. She's finally made it to the big city and has been put into a position that she doesn't want to do, but she still gives it her all. During all of this, Judy catches a glimpse of a fox along one of the streets, immediately racially profiles him and just starts following him, which I think is really good. When we first see Nick, Nick doesn't do anything wrong, but Judy just starts following him. And I think that's the first hint we get of kind of like the wider theme of this film. And I think it's done really well.
Yeah, I'd agree with that. And throughout this film, we get a lot of instances of social constructs like government and the police having these prejudices. And I think the thing that's really good, and one of the reasons Judy's character A, works so well, and B, that's so key to this film, is we know she's not a bad person. She doesn't believe that people should be discriminated against, but she also has her own biases, which she isn't consciously following, but they've just been drilled into her by her parents and by society. So that's what she does, which is an incredibly nuanced take to say, just because the effect of something like the police force does disproportionately affect people from racial minorities, but also it's not necessarily to say that every single police officer is actively racist, which, again, for a kid's film about a magical animal city, is quite a deep take. Robin Hood doesn't have this.
Quick aside, there's nothing magical about the city. It's just animals. We're not getting any wizards in the second act, just to sort of put your expectations in check. I'm glad you mentioned that Judy isn't a bad person. Her parents are, but she's not.
Oh, her parents are awful.
The part about her parents that gets me is as she is leaving for Zootopia, her care package just consists of anti-fox safety devices. And I'm like, what kind of world needs a fox-specific taser?
I mean, I suppose the logic is that if you used an elephant taser on a fox, it would just kill it. But I assume the elephant tasers are like a backpack. This isn't really anything to do with their being bad parents, but they only seem to have one phone between them, because when they call her on WhatsApp, it says mom and dad. Get with the times.
To be fair, they have got hundreds of children. Money's probably
quite
tight.
All the more reason that they need two phones.
And so Judy follows this character, Nick, into an ice cream shop. And immediately we're seeing this prejudice and discrimination where the elephant running the ice cream shop is like, get the hell out of my shop. Isn't there a fox ice cream store in your part of town? Which, again, I think they could have held back on the direct allusions to things like segregation, because I do think the film works much better as starting as like, hey, here is a story about, you know, empowerment and someone overcoming the prejudices facing them, and then it's slowly being revealed that it's about prejudice in a wider sense. And when you get things that are so directly go back to your part of town, I think the film plays its hand a little too early.
I can see what you're saying for sure. I think on the flip side of that, I think being explicit for kids is probably the way to go, because it's a very complex issue, and especially when you're doing it through an analogy of animals are different and they're different types of animals and they have traits linked with them, I do think it needs to be explicit. Obviously, as adults, we get the reference is to segregation, particularly in America in the 20th century. But personally, I think it's done really well.
The more egregious issue in this scene is that this ice cream store is absolutely disgusting.
Oh, for sure. And again, Judy's like, oh, well, I'm going to report you for a health code violation unless you serve this fox. And I was like, this is bad policing. You shouldn't...
And happy with, you know, overcoming her own prejudices and helping a fox, Judy goes about a day happily. She then sees Nick's son, who he bought the giant, a jumbo pop, I think they call it. It's about 50 times the size of this small fennec fox. Which, can we talk about the economy of Zootopia? Because I feel if people consume different resources, can they exist in the same world?
Liam, my man, yes. And that's as much depth as you're going to get.
Judy notices that something is amiss and she follows this fennec fox and sees Nick and realizes they're basically doing a grift. They're buying these jumbo pops, melting them down and selling it piecemeal, which isn't really a grift, but it is also disgusting because they think they melt the ice cream through a gutter and freeze it on the floor with pre-used popsicle sticks. What I'm saying is the hygiene in this film is not okay. Maybe they should have been more explicit with, you know, telling kids like, hey, wash your hands, maybe.
Don't be racist, wash your hands, check where your ice cream's coming from. These are the three lessons of this film. So she tries to have a bit of a showdown with Nick and he just kind of outsmarts her and runs circles around her.
Quick point about this scene, the animals buying the popsicles are lemmings and we've said it before, but Disney really should not reference lemmings. The more they can do to distance themselves from that myth, particularly not referencing lemmings as following each other. Like, yeah, it's a good visual joke for DreamWorks to make.
So after this day of consistently being beaten down, Hops returns home to a crummy little one-bedroom apartment. One joke I really like earlier on in the film where she sees her neighbours, she tries to introduce herself and they say, we're going to be really loud, don't expect us to apologise. And she has a call with her parents who are consistently terrible and unsupportive and passive-aggressive by saying, oh, you're just a meter maid, thank God you're not a proper cop, that's way safer. So she goes back to work the following day and she's disheartened and she's again just getting abuse for giving people tickets. But then she sees her opportunity because a weasel has committed a robbery. Sorry, not a weasel, Scrap from Ice Age has committed a robbery. I like how, as a culture, we've all agreed that all weasels have the same voice because it's the same voice as every weasel has in Who Framed Roger Rabbit and every other animated weasel ever.
I really enjoy this action sequence. We basically get a chase that ends up in a kind of vole section of the city. And one thing that I think is done really well, and it's quite subtle, is they're constantly changing how the cameras are framed. We're sometimes seeing it from the perspective of the medium-sized animals, like Judy and this weasel, and then we'll cut to a sort of lower camera angle representing the vole's view, and it's as if it's like, you know, a Godzilla or a monster film. And it's these really subtle shifts that change the pace of the action. And it's just one of those moments where I'm like, this is using three-dimensional space and computer animation in a way that you can't use two-dimensional animation. And I really appreciate when films do that. Like, if you're going to shut down your 2D animation department, at least justify it by doing things that can only be done in 3D computer animation. Eventually, Judy manages to apprehend the weasel, takes him to the police department, and just immediately gets bollocked by Idris Elba for abandoning her post and pretending to be a real cop, essentially, is what he implies.
He's so out of line in this sequence, because I know that's the point, right? But it is just like, you arrested a criminal and therefore you're fired. Like, that's a pretty extreme thing to do. One thing I absolutely despise in this sequence, and this is going to be a recurring theme in this film, is the very, very heavy-handed pop culture, particularly Disney references, where he already has a very heavy-handed, are you going to sing a song about what you want and it's going to magically come true? That's not going to happen. And I'm like, okay, this is heavy-handed and I hate it. And then he just says, let it go. And I was like, cool, well, I'm completely out of this film now because all I'm thinking about is that someone thought that was a clever line and I'm no longer invested in what's going on.
Yeah, my only note for this sequence is, life isn't some cartoon musical where you sing a little song and your dreams come true, followed by the words, fuck off. I realise I'm saying this now in every single revival film, but this element of the revival, I'm sick of. I don't think it's needed, and I don't think it's clever. I think the films stand as being good films despite this self-referential inward look at Disney. Sorry, the films that are good stand as being good despite that.
I just think Frozen and Tangled has Flynn Rider being a bit cynical, but he's still of that universe and he's not breaking the fourth wall. Frozen doesn't have any direct addresses, more has the subversions expected in its narrative, which again is much more subtle. But just saying we're going to reference Frozen multiple times in this film explicitly and beat you over the head with it is so distracting. One thing I did realise I really like during this sequence is, for Judy, is the way they use her ears as a physicality. So they use it all the time to represent her emotions, the way she reacts to stuff. So her ears drop at times when she's in certain emotional moods. They spring up when she's had her attention caught. But they do so much more with it. Sometimes her ears are like hair. Sometimes they are giving her more energy and a dynamic feel in action sequences. Again, they've gone, we're going to have a rabbit. Let's really lean into this physicality. They do the same thing with the legs and the jumping as well, but I think the ears, because they're a more facial feature, work really well.
I realise we implied she was fired for catching a criminal. What actually happens is we've had this setup that there are 14 missing mammals, and the wife of one of the missing mammals comes into the chief's office and is like, please, can someone just help me? The chief is like, look, we're stretched thin, we're doing everything we can. And Judy at that point pipes up and is like, I'll do it, and basically promises the world to this very distressed woman, at which point Chief Bogo is like, you're fired for insubordination, which, fair enough, like, if the police chief has made a decision and a rookie officer immediately goes against that, undermining him, I think that's a fireable offence. But obviously, he was looking for an excuse to fire anyway. And I think that is played very obviously, which I think is done quite well.
I don't know a lot about being a police officer, but I know it's always good to promise you'll definitely find missing people and they'll be fine.
To be fair, Judy does make that exact point. And rather than immediately firing her, the chief is like, fine, you've got 48 hours. If you don't find this missing mammal in 48 hours, you resign instead. And thus we have an element I love, a ticking clock. Excellent.
And so we move into the second act of this film, where Judy is under pressure to deliver as a police officer, even though all the odds are stacked against her. And the rest of the film is a detective story, really. We've got a mystery of these missing animals and what's going on with them. So Judy is poring over the very few clues they have about this missing otter, eventually realises he was sold an ice pop by Nick, so she tracks him down and basically blackmails him into helping her.
She's a great cop. Which means we've got one of my favourite genres. We've got Disney doing a buddy cop film. Granted, it's a cop and a con man, but that's still a buddy cop film.
It's a buddy cop, it's a ticking clock.
It's a sexy animal film. Ticks all the boxes.
And speaking of sexy animals, the first place they go to pursue a lead is a nudist yoga retreat.
I think they managed to execute this really well. It reminded me of in Cinderella, when we've established that mice wear clothes and then we see Gus without clothes. And in Cinderella, it's not played as anything, but as an audience, we're like, that looks weird. And here, they do the same thing, but it is, they're aware of it and they're aware that it is kind of shocking to see. And it's amazing what they're able to get away with in I think this was a U-rated film, not even PG, which to me is a misstep because I think there's quite a lot of peril in this film. But hey, I'm not the BBFC. So yeah, we get this nudist colony and we get this ridiculous shot of all of the animals doing yoga, and it's in slow motion to like saucy jazzy music. We've got bears rubbing against trees. It's just lots of blues, and it's something we've seen before, but because we're seeing it in a world in which we've established that animals don't do this, it's actually quite disturbing.
My only note is the nudists are such a furry dog whistle.
Yeah, don't get me wrong. The film would work without this sequence. They could have replaced it with something else. And really, there's a question of how appropriate it is to be in the film. But I think they managed to execute what they were going for. And I kind of admire that as a result.
We also get what I think is one of, if not the best, comedy setups in this film, where the receptionist takes them to see the elephant because elephants have perfect memories. She can't remember anything about this otter, but he keeps reminding her with more and more details about what the otter was wearing, what he was driving, what his car number plate was. That's a really good joke.
It's a really well-written comedy sequence, performed brilliantly by Tommy Chong.
We've not really touched a lot on the cast in this film, but I think the two leads are really solid. I think Jennifer Goodwin absolutely sells Hops. As I say, Hops is one of my favourite characters. I think the performance really works. Jason Bateman as Nick Wilde, I think he's a little bit playing against type here, but again, I think it really works and his voice just has that smooth quality in this.
I think the casting of Jason Bateman is inspired. I think Jason Bateman, as you say, he's playing against type. He generally plays, you know, a more upstanding and reliable. He's very much a straight man. Whereas there is a quality to him, particularly in his voice, where there is a bit of edge to it under the surface. And getting him to play that is really good. I think it was used really well in... Have you ever seen The Gift?
No. If it's not animated, Liam, I'm not watching it. We've established this.
And obviously, since then, he's gone on to get a lot of acclaim in Ozark. And I think agents and directors are starting to understand that edge. It reminds me, actually, of Adam Sandler. And Mark Kermode talks about this all the time, where Adam Sandler has this creepy edge to him, where you get the impression that the nice, funny man character that he always plays is just this thin veneer. And it took until Paul Thomas Anderson to cast him in Punch Drunk Love to truly understand that quality and use it. And I think it's really nice when an actor is able to utilize a part of their repertoire that they don't really get to very often. And particularly in a voice performance, to manage it in a voice performance. Well done, Jason Bateman, and excellent choice on the casting. So with a new lead, they decide to run the plate. Nick, seeing a way out and a way of basically wasting Judy's time, takes her to the DMV, where it's revealed that all of the workers at the DMV are sloths. Again, a nice play on sort of preconceptions the audience will have about animals. Like, personification and anthropomorphization is all about projecting our own ideals onto either inanimate objects or animals without really much basis. And obviously sloths are physically quite slow. And there's an argument to be said with, like, how accessible the joke of it's the DMV, they're really slow, is to kids. I think it works as a comedic set piece otherwise, but it is very much one of those, like, hey, don't you hate going to the DMV, kids? No.
I mean, kids probably do hate going to the DMV. The sloths are probably the most popular bit of this film, as far as I can tell. I can see that they're objectively funny. They don't massively do it for me. Maybe it's because my background's in admin and seeing someone do admin that slowly makes me scream. I am going to say this, though. I think this sequence and a bit later on with a joke around how wolves can't resist howling is actually antithetical to what this film is about. Because what this film is about is prejudice and characters having a perception of someone because of the type of animal they've got, which is obviously analogous to various things, obviously race. I think particularly at the time this film was made, there was a lot of anti-Islam sentiment in the West, which definitely was my first reading of it when I saw it in 2016. And the problem is that when they then play something like sloths are really slow for laughs, it's kind of telling us as an audience that some of our prejudices are justified because we think of sloths being slow and it's okay to laugh at that. And it's very much at odds with what the rest of the film is telling us.
Yeah, I'd completely agree with that. There are a few parts of this scene that I really enjoy, mostly to do with the animation. I think the writing is fine, as you say. You either like the joke or you don't. If you don't like the joke, this scene goes on for a very long time.
Yes, it does.
But I think the animation of Flash's slow laugh gets me every time, where his face slowly opens up into a laugh. But the other thing I absolutely love is Nick's animation in this scene, where he is very much a background character. The joke is between Judy interacting with Flash and her getting frustrated. And what we see is we can see Nick and his eyes sort of darting between them and smirking and just all these really subtle facial animations. And I just think they didn't need to do all of that, but it's so much better with what they did. So after running the plate, they find out that it belongs to a limousine service, and that is the car that picked up Mr. Otterton. So they go to investigate in the Tundra District. We get a nice sequence of Judy bending the rules, kind of going against character, but I'll allow it. This is a character who gave herself a parking ticket, and she's like, I could find a loophole around this to get into this building without a warrant.
I suppose the idea is that she's tried going down the line with Nick, and he's too savvy for all that, so she has to kind of use his own tricks against him, which narratively works really well. It's a terrible example of policing in the real world, but it's fine.
So many kids will have seen this film and been like, I want to be a crooked cop.
A And speaking of references to crime cinema...
Yeah, this sequence is really weird. I will say, when they go in the limousine and see that something horrifying has happened in the back of the limo where there are scratch marks everywhere, it is quite upsetting. Again, it's mostly told through characters' reactions, because obviously we're used to animals being, you know, not domesticated at the very least. So for us to see scratch marks as an audience shouldn't mean anything, but because we're seeing it through our protagonist's eyes, it's actually a really distressing sequence when they look into the back and just see that the back of this limo has just been completely torn up by some kind of wild animal.
As they're investigating this, Nick realises that the limousine is owned by Mr. Big, who's clearly a mobster, and he says that he's not on good terms with him because he sold him a very expensive fur that was actually skunk butt. Now, by what metric is fur acceptable in this universe? That's like me saying, oh, I really upset this person by selling them a human skin, but actually it was a very low quality human skin.
No, it is genuinely horrifying that a skunk rug, even that exists in this world.
Again, it's another example of the juxtapositions we get in this film, where we go from a really intense scene of the animalism and humanity of these characters being played very seriously to skunk butts, that's funny, even though it doesn't make any sense in the universe.
To be fair, this is Rich Moore's second feature as director after Wreck-It Ralph, so following Wreck-It Ralph, I think expecting inconsistent world building is the least we should be prepared for.
Liam, all I'm saying is I want Sonic to come along and say, skinning other animals, that's no good. So they go along and meet Mr. Big. There's a fake out of him not being a massive polar bear, but being a tiny little vole. He's Don Corleone from The Godfather.
Yeah, I'm not a huge fan of this sequence at all. I think if you've ever seen any media in which a character is called Mr. Big, you know the fake out. And I don't think just one-to-one referencing The Godfather should be done. Again, it feels much more like the type of humour you'd get in a DreamWorks film, which is fine. People like those films. Clearly, that type of humour might not be for me, but it's for someone. I just kind of expect better from Disney.
Again, there's no twist on it, really, other than that it's a little vole. It's just, I'm going to do an impression of Marlon Brando. And that's the joke, right?
It goes further than that, though. The dialogue is just ripped from The Godfather, which... that's not funny. That's very much a case of for the parents. Like, the kids might be watching it, and I'd hope the kids hadn't seen The Godfather by this point.
So because Judy saved the Don's daughter earlier on during the weasel chase, he decides to help them and gives them the details of the limousine driver who was attacked by Mr. Otterton, which they're all quite surprised by, and they go and visit him in the rainforest district.
Again, I think this flashback showing the limo driver getting attacked by Mr. Otterton is really quite upsetting and distressing when you're used to anthropomorphized animals showing them being savage is really upsetting.
And it's one thing I think this film does very well is it's a throwback to Bambi, The Lion King, all those other instances where the animators have clearly sat down and looked at the way animals in the real world move and behave in certain instances. So when Mr. Otterton has gone savage, as they call it in this film, and he's down on all fours and reared up, it looks exactly like how an otter is when it's being aggressive. The light reflects in the eyes of the predators, which again is a really nice visual way of saying that
they're replicants.
The person behind these eyes isn't real. Damn it, more Blade Runner references in Disney.
That's where it's going, right? All the 14 missing predators are actually replicants that are being recalled because they're malfunctioning.
Well, one fake out that you do get is when they meet the driver and his face has been clawed and one of his eyes has been scarred. There's a bit of an implication that maybe it's a virus or some kind of infection that's been passed on, because shortly afterwards the driver then goes savage and attacks them, which is a total fake out, but actually I think is a really good red herring in this film.
That's the type of red herring I like in my films, not just having a random duke walk in and be like, I'm evil, but I'm not the villain. It's like, okay, why are you here then?
Trade goods.
Trade negotiations.
Kids love films about trade negotiations.
again, this sequence with the Jaguar limo driver going savage is terrifying. It's a really good action sequence of Judy and Nick trying to basically get away. Like, this is a savage beast. It will maul and kill them.
During the sequence, Judy manages to save Nick's life. She calls for reinforcements and the police show up, but by the time she's taken them to where the Jaguar is cuffed, he's gone. And again, the captain uses this as an opportunity to blame Judy for this, and he says, "You failed. You said you'd hand in your badge if you failed, so give me a badge." Nick steps up and defends her and says that the captain has given her no support. He's setting her up to fail, and they've still got some of the 48 hours left. And there's a really nice moment where Judy just turns back, and she's going to say something, and she can't think of anything to say, so she carries on walking. I was thinking, that's exactly what I would do in that situation, is feel obliged to say something and go, anything I say now will only detract from this exchange, so I'm just going to walk on.
It's really nice. Nick standing up to the chief is just really sweet and really satisfying as an audience, where we've had this authority figure be prejudiced towards her, but it's always been masked behind this idea that Judy needs to prove herself. And it's like, she doesn't need to prove herself. He wants her to prove himself, and to have Nick actively call him out about that is just really satisfying.
We also get a little bit of Nick's backstory, where we get a flashback to him wanting to be a scout and basically being humiliated and hurt by the other scouts because he's a predator and they don't trust him. And it's the second instance of the child versions of our protagonists being bullied. The lesson to be learned, kids are awful.
This sequence is horrible. It's really upsetting, and I have to ask, why do muzzles exist in this world?
The same reason fur coats exist.
Because when all animals were savage, like in the era from the opening play, there would be no one to invent the muzzles. So at some point, animals had to be capable of creating muzzles and still decided, yeah, we need these.
You say this, Liam, in a world where we have nukes.
That's a very good point.
And this basically sets up Nick's backstory, where he realised people were only going to treat him based on what they saw, i.e. a sly fox. So he went, well, I'm going to be a sly fox. And again, it's a nice little moment and leads into a building of their relationship and a bit more crime solving.
I love this moment when Nick says, yeah, if the world's only going to see a fox as shifty and untrustworthy, what's the point in trying to be anything else? And one thing I love about this is kind of a parallel to Robin Hood. So in Robin Hood, the reason you use anthropomorphic animals is because we as an audience bring certain prejudices towards those animals. What type of animal would Robin Hood be? He'd be a fox. He's sly. He's crafty. What kind of animal is like maternal and caring? A hen. We have these preconceptions, and that's why we use personification and anthropomorphization. And there, it's used as a character building device for the audience. Like, if you make a character a certain animal, the audience will project onto it. And here, they're doing the same to then essentially call the audience out and say, this is what you see when you see a fox. This is what you see when you see a bunny, when you see a lion, when you see a sheep.
This also has one of my favourite pieces of writing, where Nick has this moment where he opens up to Judy, and then there's a bit of a pause and he sort of deflects it by kind of doing a jokey bit about pretending to do a traffic report. And I was like, okay, we're doing one of these bits. And then Judy just cuts him off and says, thank you for telling me. And again, that's a piece of writing that I don't think would work with a lot of other characters. I don't think you get in a lot of other films, because I think they just move on to the jokey bit to be like, okay, we've done some emotional stuff, this scene needs a joke. But the fact they do that and then call it out, I think, is really strong.
Yeah, we're in a post-Avengers world where if you're releasing a blockbuster at the cinema, you have to have a serious dramatic moment undercut with a joke. And I think it's really nice. Nick would deflect and Judy would bring it back to that and say thank you. It's just a lovely little moment. With the now savage limo driver missing and the chief not believing Judy, Nick realizes there are security cameras all over this city. Nice to know everyone is under constant surveillance and it's all for your protection.
And also the police don't bother looking at any of it.
Yeah, it's weird that, but I suppose I've interpreted it as the chief doesn't want to believe Judy, and checking the security footage might prove her right, which would be the worst thing for him. So he'd rather just end the conversation. Because again, he is more bothered about being right and reinforcing his place within this society than catching the predators.
If they've not been bit, you must acquit. So Judy and Nick go and see the deputy mayor, who has said Judy always has a friend in City Hall, and they do a bit of detecting and basically work out that the otter has been taken to a facility on the outskirts of the city that's guarded by wolves, which also links up with the night howlers that the Jaguar driver was so worried about. I really like the sequence in terms of animation. One thing that's just a really minor animation point, the wind blowing the fur of the wolves and the other animals in this sequence. Mwah! Chef's kiss. Gorgeous. Right up there with the photocopier in bulk.
It's the mundane, everyday things that make animation.
I joke, but it really is, because don't get me wrong, you know, making a nice palace in Let It Go is incredible, but the bits that really help you buy into that world is Kristoff trekking through the snow and the way it clings to his clothes, right? And I think it's the same thing here, where it's the rain effects on the glass when they're going through the rainforest section rather than, you know, the cheetah eating donuts or whatever.
I can't believe we haven't even talked about that. The rainforest...
I can believe it. Oh, I thought you meant the cheetah.
The rainforest section is so gorgeous. The water, like, they made their job so much more difficult than they had to. It's the Who Framed Roger Rabbit knocking the lamp again. They didn't have to have it be pouring down with rain, but they were like, we can do this. We're going to. You're all clocking double shifts at half pay.
And then they just play Almost There on a loop.
Sorry, I should say I shouldn't make claims about abuse of animators. This isn't Sausage Party.
I was going to say we'll get to that. I don't know that we'll get to Sausage Party.
And yeah, we get this nice sequence of Judy and Nick breaking into what seems to be a creepy abandoned hospital and effectively finding all of the missing mammals. And it's really upsetting. They're all just caged up in these cells. They're clearly being monitored by someone. Someone is aware of this, and we still don't have any answers, but we just see these feral, savage animals, each in their own cage, and it's really upsetting.
During the sequence, they see the mayor is aware of this, and he's been ordering them be taken to this facility. Judy, sick of basically no one believing her, just films this on her phone to make sure she's actually got some evidence. There's a bit of peril. Nick and Judy escape down the toilet. I don't really know how that would work, but fine, I guess. Basically, this universe doesn't have U-bends, clearly, which means flushing toilets don't work, but it's fine.
I took it to be that it's a big toilet, and even if there were a U-bend, if it's an elephant's toilet, a rabbit's going to be able to get through that U-bend.
I suppose I should probably stop thinking about animals stuck in toilets. And yeah, we've done it. We've cracked the case. The mayor's arrested. The animals are freed. They're still savage and feral, but it's a big win for the police. As the mayor's taken away, he says he was trying to help them, and they still don't know why they're going savage. And there's been conversations with the mayor and the scientists saying it's only the predators that are going savage, and maybe it's something to do with their biology, we just don't know.
I really enjoy that we solve the mystery. I mean, we don't solve the mystery, but the case is solved. We found the 14 missing mammals, and it's really deflating. I just think it's a really unique end of second act, and it all culminates in this press conference where the assistant mayor is like, let's introduce the officer who solved the case, Judy Hopps. There's a nice moment between Nick and Judy beforehand where he's sort of giving her some advice about how to do the press conference and not to be nervous. She gives him an application form for the police force, telling him it would be really good to have a partner. And Judy goes up and gives this press conference, and it's a disaster. She basically gives into her own prejudices, lets slip that the only thing we know is that they're all predators, and I guess, you know, in my non-expert opinion, it could be something to do with their biology. And Nick is watching this and is just heartbroken as she's talking about predators in this way. And as has just been the case consistently throughout this film, it's just really upsetting.
Yeah, I think this is maybe the best scene in the film. I think it's handled really well, the way it's written, because Judy kind of knows it's going badly, but also she feels that she's just being honest. You know, she's picked up these terms about reverting to their biological state from these scientists, and she's just kind of regurgitating them. And then the line I really, really like is when she comes off stage and Nick confronts her and is like, what the hell was that? And she says, I'm just stating the facts of the case. And that type of thinking is something that is key to societal prejudice, which is, look, here's the facts, I'm not putting any emotion into it, this is what the situation says. So, taking a very direct example of racial profiling and crime, ethnic minorities are way more likely to be arrested and tried for a crime, which, if you look at it at a very base level, says, oh well, they're more likely to be criminals. When you look at all the underlying things about they're more likely to be stopped, more likely to be investigated, more likely to be from lower socioeconomic areas in cities, all that stuff says that there's not really any evidence to suggest they are more likely to commit crimes, but they're certainly more likely to be prosecuted for them. It's really powerful.
And then to really sell it, when Nick asks about the predators and Judy's view on the predators going savage, she just says, you're not like them. Which, here's the point in the film where it just completely shows its hand. As I've said, I do think it could have built this up a bit slower, maybe remove some of the more explicit things, because I think that initial arc of Judy overcoming the prejudices towards her to then be flipped on its head, and it's like her prejudices basically end up tearing the city apart, is well done, but I think it is short of being perfectly done.
Judy's kind of at her lowest point now, really, so even though she's got what she wanted, which is praise and recognition as a police officer, Nick wants nothing to do with her. She's offered by the former deputy, now actual mayor of the city, to be the face of the police force. And Judy says she's broken Zootopia, and she hands in her badge and goes back to be a carrot farmer with her terrible parents.
There's a line here that I really like after Judy says that she thinks she broke it, where the chief, again, the chief is not a villain in this film. He is just someone with his own prejudices doing his job. He is still the chief. And he turns around to her and, you know, is very comforting and says, don't give yourself so much credit. The world's always been broken, which is such a good line.
And then Sisu says, maybe it's broken because we don't trust each other. And he's like, what are you talking about? We get this sort of low ebb scene. I've just written, I really like her bunny jeans. There's no other.
We'll get to that, Ben.
And she's selling carrots, and then she bumps into her old school bully, who has basically just turned out all right. He apologizes for the way he was, and her parents acknowledge that if it wasn't for Judy challenging their prejudices, they never would have dealt with him, but he's this amazing baker and he's a really nice guy. And then he mentions that the flowers that are growing in the field are known as night howlers because they make you go ballistic, basically, if you eat one of them. And then Judy realises this and rushes back to the city. I get the idea that because prejudice has been challenged, she gets information she wouldn't have otherwise. I think they could have maybe done it a slightly more elegant way. Again, I would have liked some callback to the scar on her face being a visual cue, and then she goes, wait, hang on, and it links back to something rather than just, oh, and also we're just going to tell you the answer.
Yeah, it's kind of a deus ex. I think they realise this, and there is a very, very vague reference to the night howlers much earlier, in that it's the bulbs that the weasel was stealing, but we don't have any information about that at this point. I feel that in any kind of mystery, the information should have always been there and you just put the pieces together, as opposed to giving the audience the final piece and it turns out that piece is 90% of the puzzle. And yeah, she rushes back, realizes that it isn't biology, someone is actively doing this. She goes to recruit Nick for his help, and we get the Oscar consideration scene for the film where Judy apologizes to Nick, and it's wonderful and it's heartbreaking and it is one of the best performances.
I don't mind this sequence. I feel like some of the stuff Judy says and her just sort of breaking down and crying, I don't know, it felt like a slight shift in the way that character is, but I don't mind it. It felt a bit heavy-handed.
I'll admit that the writing can be a bit heavy-handed, but my word, the performance really elevates it. Like, I completely believe that she is heartbroken, that she's hurt her friend. And we get a nice bit at the end where this audio recording pen that Judy has been using throughout the film. Nick now has it and has used it to record her apology and play it back to her and basically make fun of her a bit. They have a hug. It's quite sweet. And then they go off to investigate.
So they go and see the Disney reference weasel, who is voiced by Alan Tudyk, who makes explicit reference to Frozen in his dialogue and the character he played in Frozen. He's selling bootleg Disney DVDs that are all animal themed, including the upcoming film Gigantic. Can't wait to see that at the cinemas.
Honestly, this was very cathartic for me. I was like, that's what you get, Disney. If you're going to be self-referential and you reference something that isn't out yet, you deserve to have that come and bite you in the ass. Yeah, they clear up that the bulbs he was stealing were night howlers. Who was he selling them to? And they go to his buyer, which, okay, I'll forgive the self-referential Disney jokes. I don't like them, but I get it. I think it's self-indulgent, but I get it. I will not forgive a Breaking Bad reference.
I won't forgive either of them. I think they're both heavy-handed and knock you out of the film. We get a ram that's in the biohazard suit from Breaking Bad, and then he says, oh, Jesse and Walter are on their way over. Bad.
I really wish when I saw this in the cinema that I just got up and left at that moment, but I was too invested.
So we get another nice action sequence where they're on this train full of evidence, which blows up. They're running away from these rams, and we get our final confrontation with the mayor, who we find out she was pulling the strings all along, that the majority of the population is prey, not predators. So making the prey fear the predators and hate them is a very effective way of governing. And she then sicks the rams on a wounded Judy and Nick as they try and escape.
This is one of those twist villains that I think, although it comes out of nowhere, it works because it's a politician. And also, if you're familiar with buddy cop films, that's always going to be the case. But one thing I love about this is, again, playing on those prejudices that as an audience we have towards different animal species when you anthropomorphize them. I love that the villain was a wolf in sheep's clothing. Obviously it's the sheep. That's so good.
During this sequence, Nick seemingly gets hit with the night howler drug and turns feral. I think this sequence is absolutely horrifying. Nick goes from being this lovable, snarky fox to an actual fox trying to kill Judy, and I imagine several children crying at this sequence.
I've already said it a lot, but I'm going to say it again. You should not take a five-year-old to see this film. You know, it's not in cinemas anymore, but don't take a five-year-old. Don't show a five-year-old this film. Wait till they're six. The scientific age at which a child can process a fox mauling a rabbit without it mentally scarring them. Because that's basically what happens.
It's really grim and intense, but of course, Nick and Judy are one step ahead of the game. They've switched out the pellet for a harmless blueberry. Judy's recorded the mayor's confession on a pen. All the police show up and arrest her, and they finally solve the case. They can develop a cure for the night howler poison. We get a news report where they're saying that the mayor's been incarcerated and the animals are starting to recover with the antidote. It says a lot about the last few years of real life news where I was honestly expecting the night howler antidote is working effectively. What does this mean for Brexit?
There's something really odd about the antidote where I get what they're doing from a narrative and cinematic perspective where we rejoin Otterton, who is recovering and he's reunited with his wife and they hug. And then it pans out and Judy's in the room with them. And I just think this is a way too personal moment. Give them this moment first and then go see the officer responsible for reuniting you. And we get a lovely little speech from Judy about going out and always trying to make the world a better place. No matter what difficulties you face, it is up to you to keep trying. The world will only improve when individuals don't give up. And we see that this is a speech she's delivering to the new class of police officers, including Zootopia's first ever fox officer, Nick, which is a lovely little moment where she puts the badge on him. And then we get a quick joke where the two of them are now partners and have to go out on the beat together. By partners, I mean as police officers. One thing I love about this film is it is very much a platonic friendship. I really wish Tumblr would accept that and stop writing 20-page webcomics preaching about abortion.
The fact you sent me that on more than one occasion makes me deeply angry. So, you're right, it is platonic. Then one of the very last lines is Judy tells Nick she loves him. Now, I think that's just meant to be a very platonic, I love you, you know, we've overcome our prejudices, and I love you for who you are. And it's meant to be platonic, but I think it could have been worded better, because I was just like, wait, are they a couple now? Have we got a Kylo Ren Rey situation here? Maybe we'll find out in Zootropolis 2.
I will allow it. I am the arbiter of these things, and I'm going to allow it. I think people desperately want to see more platonic male-female friendships, and I think normalizing declarations of platonic love is perfectly fine.
And as we've established, the Disney revival is famous for its post-credit sequences, and we don't get one. We just get Shakira singing over the end credits and all the animals going to the concert and having a dance party, which I know you're a big fan of, Liam.
It's weird. It's a strange take on a dance party ending where it's a dance concert ending, but it's still, it's, they're trying to excuse it within the world as like, hey, let's have the characters go to a Shakira concert. And I don't know, I wish they'd done something more with the credits. I think it's nice. I think it's always nice where you get to see the credits roll out slowly. So you get the directors and the producers all given their due. You get the cast lined up against their characters. I'm always going to appreciate that. But it is still a dance party ending. And I wish they'd done something else. But at least we get sexy glittery tigers. If all dance party endings could have sexy glittery tigers, I wouldn't be happy with it, but, you know, I'd be less angry about it.
And on that note, before we pass our final judgment on Zootopia, Liam, is there anything else we need to talk about regarding this film?
There is just one thing. We need to add a character to our list of sexy gazelles. I mean, add a gazelle to our list of sexy characters. Because we need to decide which character in Zootopia we think is the sexiest. As always, we're referring to characters that are unnecessarily or inappropriately sexualized for a family entertainment film. And we're back in that weird area we were in with Robin Hood, where we're bordering on the furry territory. And it feels weird to describe any characters in this film as sexy, unless that's your thing. I think they probably should have considered what they were doing a bit more before they made our two protagonists, a grey bunny and a red fox, two of the objectively sexiest animals and most popular fursonas out there. But, Ben, which character in Zootopia is the sexiest, and why is it gazelle?
Well, it's the Shakira gazelle, as you say. I think it's fairly self-explanatory. I think the makers of this film certainly think the gazelle is the sexiest character. It's not an animal I'd automatically lean towards as a particularly sexy animal. I'll say two other things about gazelle. One, the pun is clearly on Adele, but they either couldn't get Adele or didn't think Adele would suit the film, but they just stuck with it anyway, which was the wrong decision. And two, you mentioned that Shakira only has one line in this film, but she does manage to deliver it incredibly flatly and appallingly, so.
I will say, though, there really doesn't seem to be as much of a fan base around Gazelle. And maybe it's because she's a gazelle. After all, you know, there's no such thing as the Playboy gazelle. It is the Playboy bunny. People love sexualizing rabbits for some strange reason. And as I say, within the furry community, Red Fox is one of the most popular fursonas out there. So I can totally see how people are drawn to either Judy or Nick. But from the perspective of actual sexualization, I don't think the animators do anything with those characters. The only character that is explicitly sexualized is Gazelle. I'm quite fond of a big, strong lion. But J.K. Simmons isn't sexualized in this film, so I can't include it. He's not wearing a mini skirt and doing a sexy dance.
I'm sure you can find it on the internet, Liam.
And so, with a sexy gazelle added to our list of inappropriately sexualized characters, there is just one thing we need to discuss. Of course, we need to decide whether or not we think Zootopia does enough as a film to earn a spot on the prestigious list of Waly Gisnep's animated classics. As always, protocol dictates, we must first retrieve the scroll. Ben, if you could do the honours.
So to retrieve the scroll, I'm going to go through the various zones and biomes of my favourite animation to get to it. So I'm going through the Cinderella sponge biome, the Bolt photocopier biome, the newly added fur in the wind biome, and I finally reach the vault from which I retrieve the scroll of Waly Gisnep's animated classics. I take out my carrot recording pen. Liam, am I going to write Zootopia on here?
This is a film I have a lot of problems with. I think that it is maybe a little too heavy-handed in parts, but as you say, maybe that's what you need when you're dealing with such a complicated social issue addressed towards children. I really like what they ended up going for in the third act. That idea of 90% of the world is prey, and yet the world is dominated by that 10% of predators. If we can create a common enemy out of those, I will always be in power. And whilst the allegories to racism and to Islamophobia and all of these other real world prejudices are there, they did manage to create something that was unique to this animal world. To have the apex species become the enemy, and to have this world that was built by and for predators, and shows the story of a prey, you know, struggling to get by in this world and then eventually realizing, hey, maybe I'm not blameless in all of this. The prejudices that I've faced, I also have to overcome. I wish throughout the film, the situations had been more unique to the world they created. That concept, that 90% prey, 10% predator, and yet the predators are in charge and the world is built for and by them, is really interesting. And I think throughout the film, where it's constantly pulling me out of it by giving very close parallels to real world issues, I find quite difficult to remain in the world that they've built as a result. That said, we have to remember the context in which this film was released. Not sure if you remember 2016, but it wasn't a great year. It started with the death of David Bowie, and it ended with Donald Trump becoming the most powerful man in the Western world.
It was the year I stopped believing in democracy.
And a big factor in the success of that campaign was certainly the prejudice and the Islamophobia particularly that the campaign was built around. And for this film to come out sort of very much in the early days, like I think the Republican Party nominations were only just underway, but the discourse had been building for a few years. Disney saw this coming. They saw what was happening and they saw where the world was going, and they made this film as their statement. And I think that alone is incredibly admirable. And whilst it's heavy-handed, a bit too referential, and makes more than its fair share of missteps, I think the core of this film is something that I really admire. So I think I want to say yes.
Normally when we talk about films on this podcast, even though we back and forth a bit on it and talk about the bits we really like and try and find some critical elements to it, most of the Disney films, I broadly feel the same way about most elements of them. So Tangled, I broadly like every part of it. Wreck-It Ralph, I think it's average overall. Dinosaur, I think, is bad overall. Zootopia is a film where I have such a breadth of feelings about every aspect of it, I really struggle to pinpoint my overall feeling about it. The world building, the detective story, the general art design, and a lot of the side characters, I think, are solid, if not amazing. Okay? I think they're decent and they do the job. There's some good parts to them. I think the detective story, whilst good, and I like there is a lot of genuine detectiving in it, I feel like it's just a little bit too bloated. Like, maybe there's just a little bit too much going on in that. This film is an hour and 45 minutes, which is quite long for a Disney film, long for a kids film. And I think that bit is probably a little bit too bloated. I think the world building is really fun. It doesn't always make a lot of sense. And as you said, they don't really explore it as much as they could do. This film has so much pop culture and self-referential material in it. It's a massive problem for me. And it may feel like I'm overstating this, but we've talked about in the past that when a film does something like a plot hole or a reference or breaks the fourth wall, it will take you out of the film. And if you're repeatedly taken out of the film to such a degree every 5 or 10 minutes, it's really, really hard to stay engaged. And these are very heavy-handed and very frequent jokes. I talked a bit about how I like the nudist memory jokes bit early on. And that's a really good example of what I think this film should do more of, because basically they've gone, the characters need to find some clues and it needs to be a fun, jokey little sequence. So they've gone there and they've gone and written a good sequence. And then all the other sections of this, with I suppose the exception of the sloths, although I've talked about why I think that's antithetical to what this film is about, all those other sequences are just a series of pop culture or Disney references. And I hate it, and they could have just written something new and creative instead. The stuff I love about this film, as we've talked about, is the theming. I absolutely love Judy as a character, and her character arc is very nuanced and very unique for a Disney character. Man, I'm so torn about this. Going into this rewatch, it was only the second time I've seen this film, first time being when it came out in 2016. I've tried to put aside my prejudices for it. Overall, I think it's good enough to make the cut, but on a different day, I might go the other way. My gut's saying what it does in terms of themes and narrative is strong enough to justify it, so I'm on the fence, but I'm going to go for a yes, it makes the list.
I'm happy with saying that our two fence-sitting half votes get us just over the line to be able to put it on the list. And so we half-heartedly write Zootopia on the... Tell you what, we'll write Zootropolis on the list.
That seems fair. I suppose it's one of those corner cases, like The Rescuers and Atlantis, where maybe on a different day I'd swing the other way. And it's the same with things like The Princess and the Frog and The Emperor's New Groove, where on a different day they may have made the list. So who knows? Count yourself lucky, Zootropolis.
I will argue that you will feel the same about it every time you watch it. The references are intrusive and they do not go away. There is a difference between an Easter egg and a reference. In The Princess and the Frog, we get loads of nice Easter eggs to earlier Musker and Clement's work. An Easter egg is either a quick moment or it's in the background. This is the actual writing. As you say, the writers have gone, we need to convey this information by the end of the scene. How can we do it and make it engaging? Oh, we'll just throw some references in. And I hate that style of writing. There's a reason we started with Disney films and not DreamWorks films. So I actually think that you're always going to be on the fence. I don't think there is ever going to be a day where you really like it and a day where you really hate it. Those references are always going to take you out of the film, but its core message and its characters are going to bring you back in. And that is a problem. As I say, I'm happy for it to go on the list, but my word, it really could have done with an extra draft to just replace the slightly iffy writing with something that actually works.
But of course, those are just the views of Liam and myself. Where do you fall on Zootopia / Zootropolis? How do you feel about the theming of this film? Does the humour of it work? Which characters do you like? And of course, who do you think is the sexiest character in this film? As always, we're very grateful for you listening to this podcast and very keen to hear what your thoughts are. Waly Gisnep's Animated Classics is available on SoundCloud, Spotify, a selection of other podcast hosting platforms, and a special enhanced version on YouTube, where we post memes, interviews, edits, and discussions of other animated films. And speaking of other animated films, there are always more to discuss. So Liam, which Disney film are we looking at next time?
Well, I was just talking about Musker and Clements, and would you believe it, it is time for another entry from the dynamic duo in the form of Moana. And I'm really keen to revisit this because you might remember that the last three animated classics from Musker and Clements have not made the list. And I'm starting to think they may have lost the magic if they ever had the magic to begin with. So I am very excited to revisit Moana and see whether it is a true classic and whether Musker and Clements can redeem themselves or whether we're going to get another film which just has all the right elements but just doesn't quite fit together. So remember to give Moana a watch and join us next time. With that, all that's left to say is thank you very much for listening. We really do appreciate it. And remember to join us next time for Waly Gisnep's Animated Classics. Try